Hi everybody, welcome to my YouTube channel Dr. Srinivas Medical Concepts and my FB page Dr. Srinivas Concepts. This is Dr. Srinivas, neurologist from Andhra Pradesh, India. I am also the medical author of the book Focus Neurology. Today we are going to talk about a very important topic, the differences between the ischemic stroke and hemorrhagic stroke. The comparison and clinical evaluation between ischemic stroke and hemorrhagic stroke. So we all know that ischemic stroke is because of the decreased blood flow to the brain, and hemorrhagic stroke is because of the rupture of the blood vessel and leakage of the blood into the brain parenchyma. So we have ischemic stroke, which is about 80%, and hemorrhagic stroke, which is about 20%. So the majority of strokes are ischemic stroke, which is about 80%, and the minority are hemorrhagic stroke, which is about 20%. The pathophysiology. What is the pathophysiological basis of ischemic stroke and hemorrhagic stroke? Ischemic stroke could be because of atherothrombosis, because of the risk factors, smoking, hypertension, diabetes, alcoholism, hyperlipidemia. There is narrowing of the vessel, endothelial injury and lipid formation, foam cell formation, what we call as atherosclerosis. Second is hypertension. When there is hypertension, there is lipohalinosis of the small vessels, causing small vessel infarcts known as lacunar infarcts. Third is embolism, especially cardiogenic embolism, atrial fibrillation causing embolism, or embolism from the internal carotid artery, artery to artery embolism. And the fourth pathophysiologic mechanism is hyperperfusion. When the heart is not functioning effectively, when the left ventricular ejection fraction is on the lower side, there is decreased blood flow to the brain, hyperperfusion. So these are the fundamental four pathophysiological mechanisms for ischemic stroke. For hemorrhagic stroke, the important pathophysiologic mechanisms are hypertension. Hypertension is the most important risk factor for hemorrhagic stroke. When there is hypertension, the end arteries, they develop pressure, they form small aneurysms and then they break. So these arteries, the end arteries, are found in certain places: putamen, pons, thalamus and cerebellum. So if you find bleed in these four sites, putamen, pons, thalamus and cerebellum, it is because of hypertensive bleed. We need not actually evaluate further, because most of the time it is because of hypertensive bleed. So if we see bleed in putamen, pons, thalamus and cerebellum, it is hypertensive bleed. The other causes are bleeding diathesis. If the person is taking too much of anticoagulant drugs or antiplatelet drug, there could be bleeding diathesis and hemorrhage. But then here the hemorrhage will not be of sudden in onset. It will be gradual in onset because of the antiplatelet anticoagulant induced hemorrhage. The evolution will be slow. Aneurysm, very aneurysm, they can rupture causing subarachnoid hemorrhage. Or AVM, arteriovenous malformation. What is arteriovenous malformation? It is a direct communication between the arteries and the veins. Generally, arteries becomes arterioles, capillaries, venules and veins. So pressure is transmitted slowly from the arteries into the vein. But when there's a direct communication from the artery into the vein, the high pressure will cause rupture of the AV malformation and can cause hemorrhage. This can be picked up by imaging. When we give contrast in the arteries, they immediately appear in the veins, early filling of veins or early dilatation of the veins, because there is no communication, there are no capillary networks between the arteries and veins. These are the four important pathophysiologic mechanisms for hemorrhagic stroke. The past history of transient ischemic attacks. Generally, a person having ischemic stroke may have in the past recurrent transient ischemic attack. They might have had ischemic stroke and then it might have cleared off on its own or with antiplatelet drugs, usually within 24 hours. So this we call as transient ischemic attacks. They are like warning signs for an impending ischemic stroke. So there may be past history of transient ischemic attacks in ischemic stroke. but there is no history of transient ischemic attacks or previous history usually in the hemorrhagic stroke. They are absent. Hypertension is one of the risk factors for ischemic stroke, a likely cause for ischemic stroke, but hypertension is a more likely cause for hemorrhagic stroke. So hypertension is a risk factor for ischemic stroke and hemorrhagic stroke, but usually for hemorrhagic stroke the association with hypertension is more. Hypertension is one of the most important modifiable risk factors for stroke. I again reiterate and emphasize that hypertension is the most important modifiable risk factor for stroke. For ischemic heart disease, the most important modifiable risk factor is hyperlipidemia. But for stroke, for brain attack, it is hypertension. For heart attack, it is hyperlipidemia. So control of hypertension is very important and very essential for stroke, brain attack, both for ischemic stroke and more so for hemorrhagic stroke. Occurrence. Ischemic stroke usually occurs in sleep, but hemorrhagic stroke occurs more with activity, when they are stressed or shouting at others. Because of the increase in the adrenaline surge, because of the stress, the blood pressure increases, there's a rupture of vessels. So hemorrhagic stroke is more found during activity, whereas ischemic stroke is more found during sleep. Evolution. The ischemic stroke generally evolves slowly, gradually, but hemorrhagic stroke suddenly it evolves. All of a sudden, person is well, suddenly he falls with right hemiplegia or a left hemiplegia. Sudden onset. The evolution is very, very rapid in hemorrhagic stroke, slow in ischemic stroke. They are general guidelines, not definitive guidelines. The recovery. Ischemic stroke, the recovery is more likely. Hemorrhagic stroke, the recovery is less likely. Why? Because there is hemorrhage, the blood starts accumulating. The more accumulation of the blood, the more it goes and compresses the brainstem because of the more intracranial pressure. Since there's a lot of edema, lot of blood accumulation, there is a raised ICT intracranial tension which can go and compress the brainstem and can cause death. Whereas ischemic stroke, there's not much of edema or raised intracranial tension as compared to hemorrhagic stroke. So therefore the recovery is better with ischemic stroke as compared to the hemorrhagic stroke in the initial stages. But if the person is able to survive on a long-term prognosis, on a long-term basis, the prognosis for hemorrhagic stroke actually is better than ischemic stroke. Because on a long-term course, what happens? The blood gets completely absorbed and therefore brain can function to some extent normally on a long-term basis. But ischemic stroke is the death of the tissue. Nothing much can be done. So when you take prognosis, we can divide it into two phases, acute phase and a long-term phase. In the acute or short-term phase, ischemic stroke prognosis is better than hemorrhagic stroke because raised intracranial tension or edema is less in ischemic stroke. But on a long-term basis, hemorrhagic stroke prognosis is better than ischemic stroke because the blood gets completely reabsorbed. Very important point in terms of prognosis and recovery. Headache, vomiting are usually seen with hemorrhagic stroke as compared to ischemic stroke. Headache, the pain, is usually because of meninges and meningeal vessels. The brain parenchyma usually has not got any pain receptors. You cut brain, there is no pain. So intraparenchymal hemorrhage, there is no pain, usually there is no headache, but because there is hemorrhage, because there is edema, raised intracranial tension, it can expand and irritate the meninges and can cause headache. In fact, we see this headache in subarachnoid hemorrhage also, where the arachnoid membrane and the subarachnoid membrane is affected, the meninges are affected. So meninges are pain sensitive structures. So if we see headache in a person who is suspected to be suffering from stroke, It is usually hemorrhage because of the raised intracranial tension. It can go and irritate the meninges, causing headache. It can cause vomiting also. So headache and vomiting are more in favor of hemorrhagic stroke. They are less in favor of ischemic stroke. Likewise, seizures are more commonly seen in hemorrhagic stroke and less likely seen in ischemic stroke. A type of ischemic stroke, that is embolic stroke, can cause seizures, but infarcts, thromboses usually do not cause seizures. So seizures are more common in hemorrhagic stroke, less common in ischemic stroke. It can appear in embolic strokes. Yeah, these are all the clinical guidelines, but we are not sure about, still we, no one can be sure clinically to differentiate between ischemic stroke and hemorrhagic stroke. The definitive way of confirming whether it is ischemic stroke or hemorrhagic stroke is taking imaging, is doing by imaging, CT scan. In CT scan, ischemic stroke appears dark, hypodense, whereas in hemorrhagic stroke, it appears hyperdense, white in color. So ischemic stroke, it is dark in color, hypodense. Hemorrhagic stroke, it is white in color, hyperdense. The treatment options. The treatment options of ischemic stroke depends upon the type of stroke, type of ischemic stroke. If it is atherothrombosis, large artery thrombosis, we can give TPA within 4.5 hours, tissue plasminogen activator, sometimes an extended period of 6 hours. Otherwise, we give aspirin. In cardioembolic stroke, again we can give TPA within 4.5 hours, intra-arterial TPA up to 6 hours, and Mercy device within about 8 hours. Otherwise, we generally give heparin or anticoagulants. In cardioembolic stroke, it is because of sluggish blood flow. There is no endothelial injury. And therefore, when there is no endothelial injury, there is no role for platelets or antiplatelet therapy. We give anticoagulants, heparin and anticoagulants. For lacunar strokes, lacunar stroke is because of hypertension, lipohydrinosis, small vessel strokes. So we generally control hypertension, we give drugs, antihypertensives to control hypertension, and we give antiplatelet therapy. For hemorrhagic stroke, the treatment, the intracerebral hemorrhage, the first and foremost is control of hypertension. Hypertension is the most important risk factor for intracerebral hemorrhage. It can cause putamen hemorrhage, pontine hemorrhage, thalamic hemorrhage, and cerebellar hemorrhage. So the most important measure for hemorrhagic stroke is to control hypertension. The second is, it could be because of bleeding diathesis, any bleeding abnormality, or because of the drugs, antiplatelets or anticoagulants. So you have to treat appropriately. Suppose some of the hemorrhages are accessible neurosurgically. For example, cerebellar hemorrhages are accessible. Superficial hemorrhages are accessible. So we can perform neurosurgery. Neurosurgical intervention can be done for certain types of intracerebral hemorrhages. Subarachnoid hemorrhage. When there is subarachnoid hemorrhage, arterial rupture, there's a blood in the subarachnoid space. Because the meninges get irritated, they have severe pain. Sudden excruciating headache, always suspect subarachnoid hemorrhage. Since the blood is generally confined to subarachnoid space and it has not gone into the parenchyma, there may not be any focal neurological deficits. Because they are not having any focal neurological deficits, we should not mistake them not to be having stroke. They still may have stroke. Because parenchyma is not affected, they may not have focal neurological deficits and they may be present only with headache. When the meninges are irritated, they have headache. The brain parenchyma per se does not produce headache. So whenever the meninges are irritated, it produces headache, like subarachnoid hemorrhage and meningitis. So when there is subarachnoid hemorrhage, it is usually because of perianeurysm, dilatation, abnormal outpouching and dilatation of the arteries. So we either do clipping or coiling of the perianeurysm. And then after a few days, because of the blood products, the vessels may go for vasospasm, and therefore we give nimodipine to control vasospasm. For AV malformation, arteriovenous malformation, we either excise or embolize the arteriovenous malformation. Arteriovenous malformation is a direct communication between the artery and the vein. Since there is no intervening capillaries, they are subject to rupture and cause hemorrhage. So we either excise or embolize arteriovenous malformation. So this is the broad overview and the differences between the arterial stroke and the venous stroke. So we have broad guidelines, then we can approach confidently the ischemic stroke and hemorrhagic stroke. I hope you have enjoyed listening to my lecture. If you have any suggestions or comments, kindly post on to my YouTube channel. But please like and subscribe my YouTube channel, Dr. Srinivas Medical Concepts, and my YouTube page, Dr. Srinivas Concepts. Thank you. Bye.